They are the ones who decide and define development for us, which is to be unacceptable. We have to really bring in even the amendment in the constitution, if need be, to say that the assemblies and the parliaments at least should have the space in the decision making related to the international agreements. Otherwise, the chief minister or the prime minister, the blue-eyed voice of these international banks and the bilateral agencies, would keep moving in the whole world representing us, 121 crores of people, with 93% of the unprotected classes not getting the pension, no housing rights, the farmers not getting the due minimum support price here in Orissa and elsewhere. How can they be represented by those who signed the agreement before visiting whether Japan, France or Australia in favor of the corporates who fund their elections? It is this process that is pushed in the name of development, non-transparent but also non-accountable, that is resisted and that is challenged by the people's movement. If POSCO, the South Korean company, comes to Orissa and tries to get an agreement signed in its favor, getting away with the land for mining as well as the plants, if the thermal power projects, 15 of those come near every water body that is created on the rivers nowadays, within 2 kilometers from the water bodies, so that all the benefits promised are diverted to them, as in the case of Narmada, where the river is going to be finished. How can that be just accepted as given by the local populations? So the resistance. When the main big claims of the benefits of the employment to be generated through these special economic zones, and then after years it is realized that the land possibly acquired and transferred to those companies who get concessions under not less than 21 tax laws under the SEZ Act of 2005. Every party right from then Bengal government to the Samajwadi government in Uttar Pradesh had brought in some resolution or other in favor of those, but finally it came as an act in 2005. And then after years, the CAG gives a report saying that not more than 40% of the employment generation statistics come true. The poor targets, 8 lakh megawatt up to 2032, that is 60% getting as the thermal power from the thermal sources, will have 6 lakh megawatt, 600,000 megawatts by 2032 from thermal. But the projects signed by now really show the capacity of more than 7 lakh megawatt today itself. The targets and the plans and the policies go haywire, and there is no monitoring mechanism on behalf of either the directly affected people or all of us who are indirectly affected. When there is so much discussion now on the pollution of Delhi city because the elites, our rulers, stay there, to rajaon ke tal mein jab aa gaya hai sun, to wo bahut chintit ho gaye hain. Ab wo soch rahe hain ki cars ki kami kaise ho har raste par. But they are also building the huge infrastructure to promote the car industries, with no control on the privatization in the car industry and the transport policy. So on and so forth. Friends, it is very essential to take cognizance of all these crises, because without really going at the root of those crises and its genesis, like the drought in Orissa or the flooding of Chennai, we cannot really come down to give a solution to the problem, which is expected not just from the activists, but also the academicians. And hence, there has to be this dialogue. I'm seeing the research bringing out the inequity as the stark reality faced. 1% of population owning 49% of wealth and so on, against the directive principle. But ek badshah hue, hazar fakir ho gaye, is principle ke aadhar par depriving others of even the basic need fulfillment, which are to be the parameters to define development, as Professor Anand Kumar said. So 467 billionaires in this country, where has the wealth of the Ambanis and Adanis come from? Those have come from the mineral resources that gives them a courage and confidence to say, Duniya meri mutthi mein. जैसे एक पूरी नदी घाटी का पानी एकत्रित करके शहरों को और कंपनियों को ज्यादा से ज्यादा देने की साजिश होती है, उस प्रकार की ये साजिश. एंड नाउ दे बिकमिंग इंडियन मल्टीनेशनल्स कॉम्पिटिंग विद द फॉरेन मल्टीनेशनल्स. व्हाट इज इट दैट द स्टेट प्लेइंग अ रोल टुवर्ड्स? स्टेट इज प्लेइंग अ रोल टुवर्ड्स प्रमोटिंग दोज काइंड्स ऑफ ट्रांसफर्स इन द नेम ऑफ डेवलपमेंट. That marginalizes not just the populations and the sections which are considered as downtrodden, but also the alternative visions and alternative models of development which could bring in the self-reliance, if not self-sufficiency, and decentralized development planning in this country and also in the world. So United Nations, which also has now the corporate entry, fails to take care and cognizance of these matters which are on. If there is a war on the border of India and China, the United Nations would immediately intervene. But what when someone questions like the Dalchin, the Three Gorges project in China, which finally is declared as not having brought the required results, but the floods in Yangtze, and hence the big banks like the Exim Banks and the World Bank do not fund the project, but the government pushes. In Brazil, the Amazon, with the people's movement, the Mavi, taking strong objection to the fact that when, as in the case of Singrauli region in India, 80% of Brazil's power comes from that valley, which I visited many times, but not even 20% of power goes back to them. So when in the name of development, the marginalization is not just displacement and not just the displacement without rehabilitation, but it is also unequal distribution of benefits, which I have just pointed out, that is questioned and challenged. And hence it is not to be taken as just a conflict between the catchment and the command, the populations in the Narmada Valley versus the populations in the Kutch and Saurashtra. Mind you, the time has come and it is happening that we both are joining hands. Because both realize that both are peripheralized and the center gains the chunk of the cake. This needs to be brought out in the analysis as well. Not just the impacts which are immediate ones, but the long-term impacts with the longitudinal research that we all know is most important. If you can engage yourself in the action research, that would go a further way. We really would welcome you, therefore, to really study the various aspects of development and its impacts through the action research, where you can be a part of the movement yourself. We all know that the latest gesture by the intellectuals of returning of the awards, reacting to one or other kind of communalism and not just intolerance but violence that emerges out of it, which created a momentum, if not a full-fledged movement, because the long-term actions that will create the momentum and bring forth a long-term vision with the immediate to the long-term goals only can be called as a movement. And it needs perseverance. Whether all these artists and literatures really join and create that kind of movement is yet to be seen. But to the extent that they have contributed to the people's, the common people's questioning of the communal attitude also needs to be welcomed and saluted. We felicitated them on 6th of December because it is not just the religion but also the caste. And it is what other day but the Ayodhya Day and the Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's Mahaparinirvan Day the 6th of December can there be to facilitate this kind of participation by the intellectuals? Friends, do not consider that as a small little gesture. Do not just question that as being a part of the party politics. Maybe those have some faith in some of the opposition parties, but that's not all. They are the intellectuals and literatures and artists who feel socially committed to the causes of the common people and the movements. And why the movements? The small citizens groups, the local communities who are reacting to all kinds of dividing and ruling policies and strategies of the electoral politicians, that is what they are taking over as their responsibility as well. Their concerns, which have gone beyond their art and their literature, is to be welcomed by all of us, and I would then appeal to all of you also to do the same. I do not know how easily it can happen, but if you are to be engaged in the dialogue on development, its politics, its economics, politicization of caste and religion, M.N. Srinivas' lecture is going to be delivered, then I would say that you can also go a little step ahead and participate to be a part of the larger movement that is trying to bring in change. The Occupy Wall Street, to Occupy UGC. These are maybe the strong actions considered from your viewpoint. Although those are the simple actions to occupy a little space and generate space on behalf of the students to the activists. But if only you can decide to do it in a way you can so easily, you can create a cadre of students who can be committed to the people's issues and people's movements. Some of them may be in struggle, some of them may be in reconstruction. Reconstruction is a part of the movement. Narmada movement is not known for its constructive work, building small micro-hydel projects, Jeevan Shalas over the last more than 20 years, with 5,000 students coming out, not as big as 25,000 students here because we are resourceless in a way, but we are resourceful with all those joining us and 17 gold medals earned by one single student as the best runner, as there are many among the Adivasi communities. It's all possible to join the reconstructive part of it, not only to study that, but also to be a part of it. And that is what you can do, if not directly, indirectly. It's necessary today to stand up and take a position with the social commitment as it has been done during the freedom movement, during the Nav Nirman movement, during every single people's movement, whether a handful of lawyers, academicians or others who join the movements, they play a great role. Five of them, here is the CP sitting here as a sociologist coming from JNU, but now serving this state. That combination is possible. You can be not just the academicians, but the actors through the action research, but also helping us to question and challenge the state, the omnipowered state, through the mass power by just being on our side. And I hope, therefore, that this dialogue would really bring out beyond the conclusions of your research work, the resolutions in the hearts of your hearts, and if possible, through this conference, that would question the local to international ways and means of looting the resources, transferring the resources, and no doubt harnessing those, but creating such a world in the name of development that really marginalizes the large majority and leaves them excluded, deprived, exploited and oppressed. That doesn't mean being cynical. That means really pointing out to the injustice. If one woman is attacked or killed, Nirbhaya, it may be named, she may be named, so much of Allah Gullah takes place. And hence, violence against individuals, to communities, to the sectors and their contributions also needs to be challenged. I only say that that is the linking of the development, marginalization and the people's movements that will link our actions, academic and governmental both. Thank you very much. For enlightening us with different facets and the inevitability of people's movements for a just society. Thank you. Indian Sociological Society not only acknowledges the contribution made by eminent sociologists across the country, but also appreciates their effort with awards and honors. Lifetime Achievement Award. No doubt we have got a number of judgments, but mind you, there has to be a research even on the legal judgments vis-a-vis the legal regime that would be more just than the present results of the legal actions, not just by the people's movements, but the lawyers' community as well. There are judges given by this very state, Justice A.K. Patnaik, to Justice P.K. Mishra and others, who have given the due space to the people's movements during our legal actions and pleadings. But that is not necessarily the situation or hope. Hence, friends, it is necessary really to see why does the conflict arise. When everyone is for development, why should there be conflict? There can be, as I mentioned, the World Commission on Dams. Beyond the differences, different conceptions and differences even about the technological choices, if not goals, there can be a real fruitful, conclusive dialogue on most of the issues, if not all. But that is lacking. Many of you have done the research on the development-induced displacement, taking note of the fact that that is not just the crisis faced by a handful of people. 6 million, did you say, Anand Kumarji? That's a very outdated 60 million. But that is 6 crores. Yeah, actually, only the large dams have displaced more than 6 crores. And the official statistics do not really take cognizance of the displacement, the primary and the secondary both. There is no record of those who get lost. Can you imagine and believe that more than 2,600 villages in Maharashtra got lost over the last few decades? It is not just marginalization, it is also killing the community. And the communities with their environments, the natural resources, but also the cultural traditions and institutions. And that is rarely studied but for the sociologists like yourselves. This should really go a long way. When the movements really bring in resistance to the certain projects and plans, they are challenging the paradigm that needs to be understood. And when they challenge the paradigm and they offer the alternatives, there are umpteen number of examples when they are crushed and discriminated. The state that engages in resistance of its own kind really do not even follow the non-violent paradigm of the large number of people's movements in this country. And hence the non-violent research, the non-violent discourses, the non-violent analysis, that needs to be pushed ahead with further and further force. The armed struggles have not brought in the results. It has given rise to the Salwa Julum, no doubt. So it is violence versus violence. But the people's movements would like to engage in the dialogue with the issues of both asmita and astitva. On one hand, it is not just the economic framework that we can follow while questioning the present development paradigm and presenting the alternative. We have to follow the issues of asmita.